welcome to the MCFP, Mission Critical Fire Protection Show. I'm Rick Reynolds, the Vice President of ORR Protection Systems. Today we're going to be talking about numerous things. I get to highlight the CO2 safety and NFPA life safety compliance. The NFPA-12 is what we call the CO2 code. So today we're going to highlight all of the aspects of NFPA-12. And NFPA-12 in 2005, there's a big dynamic change in the code. And that actually is retroactive for all CO2 systems. So today we're going to talk about some CO2 safety and also what that impact has made for the industry. So without further ado, let's get into it and let's start talking about some of the things about CO2. But before we go too far, let's talk about the impact and what CO2 or how CO2 actually works on a fire. As you've seen on the graph there, CO2 and the fire triangle that we learned from many, many years ago, the fire triangle is still in existence today. You got to have oxygen, you got to have heat, and you got to have a fuel source. And then you have to have a chain reaction in order for all of these elements to actually work in order in a controlled environment or a chain reaction for that actually to take place. And then in doing that, if you remove one of the fire triangles, then we do know that would actually suppress the fire or the fire would go out. Now, CO2 has some very, very unique properties. It can actually reduce the actual fire by actually reducing the CO2 in the area by displacing oxygen, and it can actually reduce the actual fuel vapor in the air because when it discharges, it actually displaces and it actually has a molecular structure that actually contains the fuel vapor in the air. But also, as all of us know, that CO2 is also dry ice, so that actually cools the environment as well. So it has a cooling effect. So it actually can actually atomize or reduce the fuel vapor by reducing the fuel. It can remove that side of the triangle. It can remove the heat by cooling it because we do know it's a very cold agent. And then also it can displace oxygen. So CO2 is a very good firefighting agent out there in the industry. And that's why it's so readily available and so well used in today's time. It's a lot of power generation customers still use it today. And it's a very vital product in today's marketplace when we talk about fire protection. Now, whenever we talk about it in fire protection, though, there's a lot of safety elements that we got to take into consideration. And so we're going to talk about a lot of those safety elements. But before we do, let's talk about the versatility of CO2. Now, the image that we have on the screen now is the versatility, okay? The red tank there is what we call a bulk or a CO2 storage tank, a bulk CO2 storage tank. Now, that storage tank has bulk CO2 stored in it as a liquid, and that CO2 then is actually conditioned or cooled, and it has it cooled where we can actually use multiple piping networks coming off of it, and we can use selector valves. And those selector valves can then actually go out to individual hazards. And this actually pictorial will actually give you identifiers of where we can actually send that out to. Where a conventional system or a high pressure CO2 system, it may actually only be able to shoot CO2 into one zone, one hazard, or one area. And then after it actually sends it out to that one area, if you will, you would have to recharge those high pressure bottles each individual time. Well, the benefit of a low pressure system and that storage vessel like you see there, we can actually design the system where it can have multiple shots or multiple zones of discharge. So we would discharge the system as an example for that fuel or that hydraulic sled there or that hydraulic unit. And we would discharge it once, and then we would discharge it again if need be. We can have multiple shots or multiple discharges in one area. So that's the benefit of a bulk CO2 system. And it's also benefit is where we would just have a truck come in, and then that truck would back up, and a bulk storage, they would fill up that, and then we'd be on our way instead of pulling out all of the bottles. A system this size with a bulk, you can get up to like a 12-ton unit or an 8-ton unit, a 4-ton unit. Can you imagine each of the largest size of a CO2 high pressure cylinder is about a 100-pound cylinder. So you think how many on a 12-ton system, how many bottles is that? we'd fill up that whole yard there in order to do that. So the versatility of low pressure when you start getting into power generation is really, really good for that application. And that's why it's so widely used in that. It's widely used in also the roll mill or an industrial application. We use a lot of it in those applications. So a lot of specialty types of industrial application we use CO2, and it's still used today in a very, very wide setting. But when we use CO2, we've got to take a lot into consideration. And in NFPA 12, they actually, in the annex of 12, we started looking at the actual exposure limits. Now this chart's kind of tough to read because it's so small, but one of the things I want you to look at is on the left-hand side is the percent of CO2 in the air and the consequences or the effects of CO2. And then in the middle is the duration of time that you may be exposed to that concentration or to that percent of CO2 in the air. And when you see those concentrations and that exposure and then those effects, it really, really, you gotta always take into consideration the risk and the gain of using CO2. CO2 is a very economical system to use, but also we gotta take into consideration the exposure risk. And I don't wanna actually minimize the risk whenever we're talking about CO2. We always wanna have that in mind whenever we're using CO2. Our team members are always, always taking that into consideration when we're servicing systems. We're putting flagging tape around. We're actually sealing off the area to make sure everybody's protected when we're in those environments. So it's very, very important that you're always looking at that. Even the minimum of 2% or 3%, you always have to take that in consideration. When you look at actually some of the durations there, some of the minimals that you would see there, if you're at 3%, even at 3% at a dilution rate, you'll start getting nauseated, you'll start getting dizzy. You'll start actually having the possibility of passing out. Look at it, at 6%, you'll start having tremors. So, and you'll start getting headaches and you'll actually start getting some other things. Well, in a normal power generation setting, okay, a normal power generation setting, the percent of concentration that is required in a CO2 environment. Now, a base CO2 system, no matter what the actual environment, NFPA 12, the CO2 code that we were talking about, it actually has the base concentration for all systems at 34%. Now, when we start talking about lube oil skids, we're talking about turbine packages, we're talking about electrical packages, look at the concentrations that are minimals. So, and these minimals are based on the hazards that we're protecting. So, an electrical hazard you'll see is 50%. Well, the reason for that is the amount of density of hardware that's in the space. A lot of plastics, a lot of density plastics, a lot of very, very hard to reach types. So you run into what we call a deep-seated fire. So they want to have a higher concentration in those areas. But even at those, you see the 36%, you see the 50%. And then look at our percent of air. So you see really, really quick that we can run into a percent of air versus an effect. So we'll run into a high concentration, high effect. So you got to take CO2 safety into consideration. Now this chart came from the Compressed Gas Association, or the CGA, if you will. Now CGA comes out, and what I was trying to show is that we've got a couple, I got one more chart here behind this one. And so NFPA comes out and they gave their information. CGA, which is Compressed Gas Associations, they came out and they gave another one. Now, what I highlighted here is that 15%, you actually start having tremors at 1 minute of concentration exposure. 1 minute. Now, if you remember on that previous slide, we said at 36% is what we typically protect a lube oil skid. So in a power generation customer that may be watching this or listening to this or involved in this, you can see only 1 minute of an exposure and you're going to be actually the possibility of tremors and having some reverse effects. And then you become unconscious at 20 and 30% at only 30 seconds. And so you really, really got to be careful because of the high concentrations that we may be dealing with in some of these environments. Look at this next slide. This next slide came back from the Internal Journal of Emergency Medicine. Now this was actually just published in 2017. So we're not talking about old data. You know, a lot of times people, when they're given presentations about CO2, because CO2 was such an old agent and it's been around for so long, a lot of people pull up old data from way, way, way back. And I understand that. I've been in the business, like I said, for a long time. You know, even working before ORR, I was in the business. And I think it's important that we don't pull up old data and we share the statistical data from old. This is 2017, April 4th of 2017. And so as you read this, you can see that some of the risk associated with this. Well, this next part of the slide is the most disturbing. And in 1980, it showed that there were 89 deaths per year in the U.S. alone. And that's in 1980. Now, you would think, well, Rick, that's old data. And it is old data. I'll give you that. However, what we don't want to, you know, not look at is the next section. And OSHA, which is the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, they came back and said, hey, in 2015, they're still seeing that the estimated number of deaths because of confined space or because of CO2 deaths is still averaging around 90 per year. 90. This is a real problem that we still have around CO2. NFPA did some massive undertaking in order to help prevent this. And that's the reason why NFPA-12 was reorganized or is refitted for today's time. And the refitting had to happen. And unfortunately, that number continues to be there and it continues to rise. And if you see 2/3 of those deaths is probably because of the would-be rescuers, you know, and those would-be rescuers are the folks that see a man down or a lady down and they ran in to try and rescue them. And that's the problem. And so we all have to be very cautiously aware of, you know, knowing that, hey, there's somebody down, I'm going to go get them. Well, CO2 is an invisible agent. So once it discharges and the temperature comes up and the atmospheric temperature of those molecules get and it dissipates to room temperature, then you can't see CO2. So you don't know what the concentration is in that space. You may run into a highly concentration area and you're not knowing it. And then all of a sudden you can become overcome with that same high level of concentration of CO2. So really, really got to be careful with CO2. It's an awesome agent, good firefighting, good ability to suppress. Remember, it'll take out all three sides of the fire triangle, but we have to be very cautious in doing that. So the proficiencies. Or put together this little chart. And if you'd like a copy of this and you want us to send it to you, we'd be happy to. All of our PowerGen customers, we try and give this to them to post on their bulletin board, just as a reminder. It's not a bad thing to have it out there as a reminder. It's not a scare tactic, it's a reality. That CO2 is a reality. 1%, you see the chart, the correlation, 3%, 5%, and above 8%, let's be honest, there's some really, really things that happen there, the unconsciousness and so forth. And so now we're gonna actually show you a complete discharge. And during this discharge sequence, we're gonna show you the electronic audibles and you'll see the strobe in the background. And then we're also gonna be able to hear the pneumatic siren, which is part of that NFPA-12. And then we'll hear the discharge, or you'll be able to see the discharge coming out of a nozzle. And then we'll be able to watch the entire cycle. Now, of course, at ORR, we've shortened this discharge for time's sake, but there are numerous folks, when I've done interviews across the actual portfolio of ORR, that have had CO2 protected zones and protected hazards, what we call hazards, for many, many years that have never seen a CO2 discharge in video form or in real live form. So being able to see this is really impactful. And there's some key elements that I'll point out along the way, but let's watch this together because I think you're gonna be able to see some things that will also enhance the idea of why NFPA actually went to the extreme of doing some of the safety enhancements on the standard that they needed to because of what I've actually showed you or shown all of the safety enhancements that are required now. So let's watch this together. So this is, like I said, it's a lube oil skid and it's a discharge test that we actually provided for a customer of ours. So that is the audible circuit of the electronic audible. You see that strobe in the background that's going off. So I'm going to turn it up just a little bit. So in that, you can hear that the audible circuit is, and the reason why you'll hear a pneumatic siren start up in just a second. Think of this where if the audible circuit was shorted out or it did not work, then all of a sudden you would have CO2 coming into the space, unprotected. So that's why they want this pneumatic siren in there. So now that pneumatic siren is powered by CO2 or even by nitrogen. So it's a very loud sound in the space. So and that siren needs to be inside the space according to the code. As it says, it typically runs for about 30 seconds or however long it takes for somebody to evacuate that space. So it's running for 30 seconds now, and that's the actual time that we're being able to witness it. Now we have CO2 discharge. So you'll see in that back nozzle back there, here it comes. And it will actually, as it discharges within the space, then we have a complete visual obscuration within about 12 seconds. And so, as this system discharges, complete whiteout, complete obscuration, and if you were in the space, that concentration just went up to beyond the, we would have displaced all the oxygen in the space by now, or got the oxygen level well below flame front of what it can actually sustain flame front. So at this point, this particular lube oil skid required 3 minutes initial and a 40-minute extended discharge. So we have a little bleeder nozzle in there that would have been actually bleeding CO2 into this space for 40 minutes to maintain that concentration. That's what's so unique about CO2. We can extend that discharge for that duration. Now, what you'll start seeing is CO2 will start dissipating in visualization where you'll think, okay, well, I'm okay to go into that space. But remember, CO2 visualization or CO2 gas, once it comes up to temperature, it's an invisible agent. So you don't know what the concentration of agent in that space really is. And that's where that hazard really starts coming into play. And that's where those would-be rescuers come into play where they're actually going down. So, and then on the screen, you'll see in just a second where we actually bring up that, of course, toxicity chart, where we really want to remind folks about that toxicity. And then, of course, the versatility of course, CO2. But again, when we're talking about CO2 and we're talking about migration of CO2, if we were discharging for 40 minutes in that extended discharge, think about how much CO2 could be migrating outside of that those leak unclosable openings or those leak areas where it may leak into the next little compartment. And if you were walking up to that zone or into that area, you could be walking into a highly enriched or an enriched concentration of CO2. So that's why it's very important for oxygen monitors and making sure that you understand that, hey, am I in a oxygen deprived environment? So this video has been very, very useful to a lot of training classes. And if you would like a copy of this video, please reach out in the question and answer session. I'd be happy to share this with you and with your team. So that way you may be able to share that with your on-site personnel as well. At your leisure. So very good data there. So NFPA 2012, the impact of changes. Let's talk about that. What has changed and why did it change and how is it developing for you as a CO2, maybe a CO2 system owner or maybe as the EH&S personnel at the plant or somebody that's actually a responsible person at the actual company or the authority having jurisdiction. Say you're the authority having jurisdiction, and what do I need to be looking for in these systems that are already installed? Remember, NFPA 12 is retroactive. So that means that any system that was installed from point zero all the way until 2020, this is all retroactive. What do I need to be looking at as well as the authority having jurisdiction? So, and the reason for change again, life safety. I cannot stress that enough. It's about the life safety of personnel and the life safety of the folks around that could actually be impacted by this CO2 being discharged. So it's for both new systems and existing systems. Like I said, it's retroactive. I can't stress that enough. So how are we going to accomplish this? We're going to look at all types of systems, the system actuation devices. We're going to look at modifications that have been done to the system. So what types of systems are affected? Well, the total flood systems, and that's just like the lube oil skid that you sent. See, those are total flood. We're totally engulfing or totally flooding that space. Total flood systems apply to normally occupied and non-occupiable spaces. So those are very, very key words to know about. Local application. You know, a local application can be a quench tank or a dip tank, or what we call. It can be a hood system where we're actually just protecting a wet bench, if you will, or something like that. So those are local applications. We have a paint booth, as an example, can be done as a local application environment. So a lot of different local apps, a roll mill in a steel factory, as an example. We protect a lot of roll mills where the actual only thing we're protecting is that roll mill as the steel's going across the conveyor and we're using across two roll mills. Then we would protect just that area. Well, that's local app. Well, CO2 migration. Well, life safety comes into play with it as well. So NFPA 12 covers that as well. So it's very important that we take that into consideration. Impacts of change is the normally occupied space. It falls into that category. So we have control rooms today that are still protected with CO2. Computer rooms that are, IT rooms, believe it or not. Laboratory rooms, like I was saying, MCCs are normally, I mean, I walk into MCCs on a regular basis, especially in the power generation sector, that marketplace, they have a lot of motor control centers that are still protected with CO2. And then we're actually upgrading those to a clean agent, a different alternative fuel, I mean, a different alternative suppression system, but they are still protected today with a clean agent with CO2, and we're using alternate suppression means. Electrical switchgear rooms, like this picture in here. This is a perfect example of an opportunity there to switch that. Now, the next image is going to be for a normally unoccupied area, but it's occupiable. An example of that may be a turbine enclosure, a cable spread room, as it shows there. And where you would enter it occasionally, but you could go in it. This is a different type of a fuel oil room or a lube oil room. But as you can see, you can go in that space. Those two little cylinders there right in front of us, those are filters. And so there are times where an associate may need to go in there and change out those filters or one of your actual team members. And in doing so, they would enter that space, and maybe that's an armed system or a live CO2 system. And so that's really a occupiable in a normally unoccupied space. So it can be occupiable, but it's normally unoccupied. So as the, you know, I tried to use this as a video to kind of show you, even though it's really an unoccupied space, unoccupiable on a regular basis, but it's occupiable. So it's very important to understand what the differences are there. So, and then of course, this next video is for a totally unoccupiable space. These are really permitted zones. These are permitted areas where we would call it to actually be a permitted confined space, permitted area. So an exhaust, this is a exhaust plenum or a load bearing tunnel is what this is for. And that little bitty room there, that little hatch, that's a load bearing tunnel for a turbine enclosure. And so that's we would actually consider that to be a confined space, but that is still a unoccupiable space where we would not occupy that at all. However, it is still an area that needs to be protected with CO2, but that would actually still fall into what we would call NFPA 12. And that's an impact of changed area. So very important to understand that. Now, this is an example of a high pressure system. You know, I've shared a lot about low pressure and the impact of low pressure and kind of explained all the selector valves and all. Well, this actually holds true also on high pressure. No difference really. On the high pressure system, you have all the same sequences, if you will. We have a siren, pneumatic driven siren. We have a pressure discharge switch. We have a audibility. We have a maintenance switch and so forth. So a lot of these same configurational parts and pieces are on a high pressure system just as well as it is on a low pressure system. So they both come into play on both types of systems. So it doesn't really matter what type of system it is, because both systems actually have the same types of systems that they are. Existing systems, there again, the code, these are code driven types of system identifiers. And so here is the retroactivity word that is used in the code in NFPA-12. And so in the what we would call the National Fire Codes, we really look at two words out there. There is a should and then there's a shall. Those two words mean a lot to us that are in the industry, and the authorities having jurisdictions that are out here, they are very, very keen on those two words. One of them being should is really kind of a recommendation. It's a recommended practice, if you will. Shall is it's actually a mandate. It's a true requirement. We have to actually take care of that, if you will. And so that is a write-up offense, if you would. Shall, like I said, should is just a recommendation, and shall is a true offensive thing where we have to actually write that up. So these are all shalls. So 1 through 6 are shalls. We shall have proper signage. We shall have stop maintenance lockout valves. We shall have discharge pressure switches and pneumatic timers and pre-discharge sirens, and of course provisions for entry. So the signage, you know, we talked about signage as number one, and signage is the easiest and the fastest way that we can get protection to the space. And this is a warning sign that is actually shown in the bottom right of the screen. And that sign is an older style. Now, what they tried to do was, because there's so many signs out there, we've got everything from paper signs up on doors to all kinds of signs that I've seen out in the industry. And I think what we're trying to depict here is that ANSI, or the American Standard Institute, they finally said, you know what, let's get all the signs being the exact same out there. And so what the NFPA even came across with sponsorship was, we want all of our signage to be the same. And so what they did was they said, you can no longer use this warning sign like it is. Now we've got to have what we call the one man lung. So now when you see the one man lung out there, everybody should automatically start registering that that's CO2. And that's what they tried to do, was make it universal across the platform and across the industry for CO2. Now, every time we see that one man lung, we know that, hey, it's a toxicity. It's actually CO2. We need to back off. We need to look at protection here. So that's what it's all about. It's all about that CO2 toxicity. So that's where the one man lung came in. And that's what we term it, thus us that are in the industry. So changing out signs immediately is a quick first step into it. So if you've got a CO2 system and you need to start doing some first steps, my recommendation and ORR's recommendation is immediately reach out to us or reach out to your provider and get some signage. That's the easiest step. And there's about 5 different signs, and I can show you a couple of those out of the gate, but there's about 5 different signs that really have to be incorporative on your site. So, but we'll talk about that in just a minute. So maintenance lockout valves. You know, what is the maintenance lockout valve and how does it work and what's its main purpose and function? So its main purpose is to prevent an accidental discharge. The whole driven fact behind it is to make sure that we're locking this thing out. If somebody's going to be working in and around the system, they want to make sure that we are actually preventing all of that energy of CO2 going in the space that somebody can be working. And that's for all safety aspects. And so that's the key thing, is lock it out, tag it out, and make sure nobody's going to get CO2 sprayed on them or in that environment. And so the code change was most systems have a lockout valve on them, and most of them are at the tank level. And that's legal. That's 100% of it. It meets the intent of NFPA. However, the new layer of NFPA in 2005 was, see that next bullet point where it says supervision? That's the key factor. Up until that point, supervision wasn't in the actual document. Now we've got to take it into the supervision level. So now supervision must be provided. So now I got to have that monitoring box at the top. It's one thing to have the locking mechanism, but to have that supervisory block up there that actually has electrical connection going back to the panel, it's very important now that that is actually, electrically supervised as well. So it has to have both mechanisms on it. It has to have the lockout valve capable as well to have a lock on it so we can lock it in its off position, but it also has to have the electronic or the electronic notification back as well. So it's a two-stage type of valve configuration. Now, if you have multiple zones coming off, like on those low pressure tanks that I was showing you, say if you have one master valve at the tank and it leaves the tank and it goes out to say 4 or 8 zones coming off of it, and those are selector valves, well, the code does give us a little bit of tolerance and says that as long as you're not going to work on any of those other zones live, you can use that master valve at the tank as the main lockout valve. Now, I've seen some types of companies or some companies out there, and they would say you got to have a lockout valve on every one of those lines. Well, if the client wants to lock out each individual valve and each individual line, that's perfect. That's no problem. That is an option. However, the code does give us a little bit of tolerance and gives us that capability of only locking out that one valve on the tank. So it does have a little bit of grace period, if you would, in order to help us in costing factor, where all we need is that one on the main tank. Now, to install that master valve on the main tank, if you don't have it, we do have to bleed the master of the big tank, but that we can work through that. It's not as painful as it may seem. We do this on a regular basis, so it's not as painful as it may appear. So a discharge pressure switch, you know, what would that be used for? Well, a discharge pressure switch is mainly used to enunciate the panel that somebody has manually activated the system. And most of our systems out there today have a pneumatic capabilities of being discharged. And then if a system is pneumatically fired by having a pneumatic operator on it, and I'll show you in a picture here in just a second, but that pneumatic firing, then we want the actual panel to be able to enunciate the audible circuit. And that's what one of these pneumatic operated pressure switches are for. So if you look at the top, that is a input for a pipe to actually apply pressure to a contact switch in there. And then that actually will shut down the dampers or shut down the drive process or whatever. But that's what that's for is. So that's a pressure operated switch. And that's a code compliance opportunity as well. Pneumatic time delay bottles and times. That's what those are. So those are what we call accumulator bottles. So CO2 would accumulate in that bottle. And then after it accumulates for over 60 seconds or 30 seconds, whatever the duration is, then once it accumulates so much, it back pressures back and then it would finally fire the actual piston on the actual main discharge line. So those are accumulator bottles to build up pressure till it would finally fire out at the actual piston line. So that's the pneumatic time delays that are required on a system now. So a new feature to a lot of systems out there that do not have pneumatic time delays. So very, very important that we put these, and they shall be provided. So that is a shall be provided. Pneumatic pre-discharge sirens. On that discharge that I showed you that video, you heard that siren come up to the loud noise after the electronic audible. That's what that was. You'll see the connection point on the bottom left of that siren. there's just a pipe that goes from whenever that pneumatic tube that I showed you, that tank was filling up. While it's filling up, there's a T that goes out and it has that siren. That siren and that tube is filling up at the exact same time. So while it's filling, that siren is also spinning at the same time, creating that noise. And so that's about 90 to 110 dB at 10 feet away from it. Very loud, and it's in the space for enunciation to have people evacuate. Again, NFPA required shall be provided in the space. So all total flood applications, all local applications are required to have that, that could actually migrate CO2 into those spaces. So very, very useful tool right here for personnel. And the reasoning again, why a pneumatic siren? I've had this question numerous times, Rick, you know, why do I need a pneumatic siren? I've got audibles. Well, you do. But if that audible circuit is shorted out or a ground fault on the system or something like that, then if somebody pneumatically fires the tank or that bottle because the pneumatic's on that system and you can manually discharge that and that panel is down for some reason, whatever the reason may be, and that panel is down and it's out of service and you actually discharge that, then there's a possibility CO2 can discharge in that space without any audibles at all. That's why that pneumatic siren becomes so important. So having that in place is a very, very useful safety item. So here's that pneumatic setup that I was talking about. This is an example of a turbine enclosure panel. There's thousands and thousands of these out there. You know, GE had this custom made. This is a Cardox custom made kit. As you see here, the pneumatic time delay bottles are in the bottom right. The pneumatic levers in the bottom on the far right in the middle, those are emergency manual releases. So if you needed to operate those, you would turn the handle from the left to the right or from the right to the left, according to the picture. And then the pilot pressure switch, it's just some supervisory lines. The pneumatic siren lines up there at the top left, that kind of shows you where the actual CO2 sirens would be hooked up to from the controller panel to out to the field. A discharge pressure switch, we kind of reviewed that a little bit of where it's located. And then the the emergency bypass switch. So in the event that you would have a need where you would say, hey, I'm going to manually discharge my system because I need to have CO2. I've seen the fire, I've confirmed the fire, and I need CO2 right now. And I don't want to wait on this 30 seconds pneumatic time bottle to fill up before I can have CO2. I've already evacuated the space. I know nobody's in there. There's a handle that would actually give you emergency CO2 in order to suppress the fire immediately. So there is an emergency bypass, if you will. So there are a couple bypass features on this to give you emergency CO2. But of course, those are manually overrides and you're taking a lot of responsibility when you hit those. So just be very cautious that, you know, knowing that they're there, but also cautious that you're taking that upon yourself when you actually trigger those. So be cautious when you're thinking through those. The code, when it starts talking about prohibitive entry, this is where it gets very, there's some a flexibility, I'll just say. So you must make provisions for prohibitive entry. And a odorizer, there's a term in the industry for CO2 called an odorizer. And that's a distinctive oil of wintergreen. You know, when you smell natural gas, there's a distinct smell for natural gas. Even though natural gas is odorless, they actually inject a scent into natural gas so we can all smell it just in case we have a leak at the home or a leak at a industrial plant or a power plant, we'd be able to smell it. Not all power plants use that same, they may be on the main line and not actually have the odor of the natural gas in there. But in saying that though, CO2 being odorless, we have to be very careful that we may walk into a hazard that is CO2 enriched. So the code kind of gives a little bit of tolerance where you wouldn't have to put an oil of wintergreen or an odorizer on a system as long as you can confirm that the space does not have greater than 4% CO2 by volume. Now, the only way you can do that is by manual meters. That meter that's on the bottom right is a manufacturer that all of our technicians or all of our recommended is most, you know, if you're going to be working inside of an area that has a CO2 system, having a little portable meter like that, you know, I wear one myself when I go out to a plant and we have a CO2 system, I wear that particular meter right there. That's a 4-channel meter. It's an oxygen. It's a parts per million meter on some other channels of other gases. But the main thing is it's oxygen. So if we have a CO2 leak in an area or if we had a discharge, I would know how far away the CO2 is migrated to know where oxygen deprivation could be. So we all wear these meters, every one of our associates on the team. So that way, you know that you're at or greater above 4% parts per million, I mean 4% CO2 concentration, not parts per million, CO2 concentration by volume. So it's important that you're able to do that. If you cannot meter that, then the code says that you have to do an oil of wintergreen. So that's kind of the trade-off as the code was giving us a little bit of more tolerance. They said, if you can't do the metering, then you've got to do the actual oil of wintergreen. If you don't do the oil of wintergreen, then make sure you have some type of metering. So that's kind of the other side of the trade-offs associated with that. So kind of both sides. So let's do a little review. Let's kind of cover where we've been and what is actually a code compliance, if you will, of life safety compliance for NFPA, and what is the enhancements that are needed on a CO2 system. So real quick, lockout valves. I mean, I think that was an easy fix, if you will. Lockout valves that are monitored. Keeping those monitored is very, very important. So monitored lockout valve is important. Pneumatic siren, you know, having that pneumatic siren, and that's a safety, that's an awesome safety feature if the panel is down and your electronic circuit, maybe it had a water got in the circuit and shorted it out and you still was operating and all of a sudden you needed to have the panel go into alarm to discharge CO2 and the discharge circuit still works, but my audibles don't work, or that audible got wet and it's corroded or whatever the case is. You know, that pneumatic siren is a good safety measure because it's going to operate just about in any condition. So odorizers, we just talked about those. Sometimes it depends. If you want an odorizer because of CO2 migration, if you've got a space that's above and you got another space that's down below, CO2 is twice as heavy than air. So that may be a good time to actually install an odorizer if you've got spaces that you're protecting that are above another space down below and CO2 can migrate. Because like I said, it's twice as heavy than air. It's going to accumulate at the lower levels. So be very cautious of that. So an odorizer, we talked about that. System pressure, discharge pressure switches. We know that those are required on the discharge outlets of, or when the discharge line, whenever it goes into discharge mode, as the CO2 discharges, it actually trips it back at the panel to shut down the actual system, to enunciate the actual panel that we've had a pneumatic firing of the system. And so that way it can turn on the audibles or it can actually stop the process or shut dampers or something like that. Pneumatic time delays. That's the pneumatic bottles that fill up with CO2 prior to actually actuating the actual CO2 valves. So kind of a part that's actually working side by side with the pneumatic siren and the pneumatic time delay. It takes both of those features in order for those to work together. And then, of course, safety signs. I can't stress safety signs enough. And I said I was going to talk a little bit more about safety signs. So I've got a couple of them here that I wanted to highlight. So this is one of them right here, and it may be reversed, but I can read it out to you. So It says warning. Again, one man lung kind of shows right there, but caution, carbon dioxide gas can cause injury or death. Actuation of this device causes carbon dioxide to discharge before actuating. Be sure personnel is clear of the area. So this sign is actually required now at every pull station. And think about that. So if we got a pull station that is out near or away from the hazard, and you were going to pull that pull station, all right, and as soon as we got ready to pull that pull station, it's kind of a reminder to let us know, before you pull the pull station, make sure that you think through the process. Is there anybody in that space before I pull it? Because once I pull that, this carbon dioxide, before actuating, be sure personnel are clear of the area. So it's a good safety measure just to think about before you pull the pull station. So at every pull station, this sign would be required. So I've got another sign here is CO2 gas can cause injury or death when alarm operates. Do not enter until ventilated. So this is actually at the doors. So this sign here is kind of required at the doors. So every door going into the space is required to have one of these. And I'm not going to go through all the signage, but this is another one. This one here is kind of critical because this one here says CO2 or carbon dioxide gas discharges into nearby spaces can collect here. This is what I was talking about. If you had an upper level that was protected and a lower level that was not protected, well, it's twice as heavier than air, right? So there's a good possibility that it may migrate down to the lower level. And CO2 migration, that's that would-be rescuer, where CO2 went to that lower level and it accumulated down there of a higher concentration and you just didn't know. It's a visible agent. You went down there and you went down there to check on something and CO2 was a high concentration down there. You got down there, you stayed down there for a minute. It was above 8%. You passed out. Next thing you know, the next guy looked down there. He seen you there. He went down to get you. And there again, we have two problems that actually existed there. So this is a caution. CO2 can actually migrate to low-lying areas or to other areas. This is a cheap sign, inexpensive security as a reminder. So these signs, like I said, if you need these upgrades, CO2 signage is the first step that I think you can do very inexpensive. So reach out to us, let us help you with that, because I think we can do that fairly quick and fairly easy for you. So again, ORR Protection Systems Power Generation Team, we've been doing CO2 systems for years and years and years. I've been here 30 years and CO2 has always been in our wheelhouse. It's always been in what we've done and what we do. I look forward to your questions. I look forward to if you want to have a lunch and learn at your site. We sponsor these all the time at plants. Or if you want a training class or a highlighted training class at your plant, please reach out to our team. If you're an engineering firm or an authority having jurisdiction, you guys want a lunch and learn at your site specific, customized to your plant or customized to your location, please reach out to us. We'd be honored to do that. I mean, that's what we do. So, and we do these all over the country. And we've even stepped outside into other parts of the extended area of the world. So if there's some areas in the Caribbean or outside of that area, we actually work in those areas as well, very well. So again, ORR Protection Systems, we specialize in this area of CO2. We got years and years of experience in this. We'd love to partner with you. I look forward to your questions. I will answer all of those. And I just appreciate you guys and your attentiveness to today's presentation. If I can ever be of assistance, my name again is Rick Reynolds with ORR Protection, and our team is willing to do whatever we can to partner and support you in any way we can. So I want to thank you and thank you from the bottom of my heart and ORR's heart that we just appreciate your attentiveness today. So have a safe rest of the year, and stay healthy and stay safe, and appreciate you more than ever. Thank you. Good day.